Hello, I'm Jorge Gestoso. Welcome to a new show. On today's program, what is fascism in the US? Our guest, Sansara Taylor, co-founder of Refuse Fascism. Sansara Taylor, a warm welcome to the program.
Thanks so much. I'm happy to be with you, Jorge.
Sansara, I'm seeing here a poster that says, no, huge no. The Trump slash Pence regime must go. In the name of humanity, we refuse to accept a fascist America. What's going on here?
Well, it's a very straightforward sign, and it is, like it says, in the name of humanity. This is a sign that is looking at things not just from the perspective of people living in this country, but from the whole world. The Donald Trump, Mike Pence regime, and it is a regime, we can talk about that too, is a danger to all of humanity. And we call it a fascist regime, because it's not just the worst of the Republicans. They are undertaking a qualitative change in the form of rule in this country, one that is rules through open terror, violence from the state, whipping up violence from the mob from below, against immigrants, against Muslims, against oppressed people, eviscerating democratic rights and civil liberties. And fascism, the lesson of history, is it has to be stopped before it is too late, before it's consolidated.
Is something a new phenomenon, this? We're talking about something that appears 18 months ago, 20 months ago, when Donald Trump arrives to the White House, or something that was already on the air?
In this country, look, America was founded on genocide. It was founded on slavery. There's a long history and roots of oppression in this country. And we should talk about that too. What is this system of capitalism, imperialism that we live under? But in recent decades, there's been a rise of fascism, which is an even more extreme form of imperialist rule.
Why?
Well, I think it's there's a lot of challenges that this country is facing in the world. Globalization, economic changes, demographic changes in this country. There's the aftermath and divisions still from the 1960s, the powerful liberation struggles in this country for the rights of black people, for women. And there's a revenge against that. That's a big part of this, is a reassertion. There's a section of the ruling class, Donald Trump, Mike Pence. Mike Pence represents a whole Christian fascist wing that's been building up for decades, to reassert white, patriarchal, openly terroristic form of rule in this country, to really make America white again, and to terrorize and ethnically cleanse and clamp down on anybody who would challenge that. And they feel that this is their shot. They have to go for it now. They're remaking the courts. They're rounding up children, immigrants in detention camps. And they're really doubling down. And a lot of people, I mean, look, millions and millions hate Trump and Pence. But most people are not confronting the full scope of this danger.
You're talking about American chauvinism.
Yes.
What's that?
American chauvinism is the disgusting notion, the immoral notion, that American lives are more valuable or precious than other people's lives. It's the notion that people can go on about their businesses. Right now, Donald Trump is backing Saudi planes that are bombing and destroying the ports in Yemen, causing a famine. 8 million people in that impoverished country.
Humanitarian crisis.
Yeah, on the verge of starvation. 8 million people. 1 million people with cholera. It's 2018. Why should anybody on the planet be suffering from cholera? And it's unnecessary. But you go out on the streets in New York, people are going about their lives. It's not happening to me. It's not happening here. That's American chauvinism, and it's immoral, it's intolerable. And it's one of the reasons we raise the slogan, in the name of humanity, we refuse to accept a fascist America. Because again, Trump and Pence are threatening the whole world. They're not just threatening people here, they are threatening people here. But including the environmental deregulations, withdrawing from the Paris Climate Accords, ripping up environmental protections, this is, when you destroy the planet, the air, the oceans, all of this, you're destroying it for the whole world, not just for the people in this country. So American chauvinism is something that is bred into this country. It's the patriotism, it's America first, it's all of this, and people have to break out of it.
You say American is a force for good in the world, or they have done things with good intention.
Yeah, you're quoting from a really powerful segment of a speech given by the revolutionary leader, Bob Avakian. And he said, you know, we need to free ourselves from the GTF. And the GTF is the great tautological fallacy. Great, everybody knows what that means, enormous. Tautological is it's a circular logic. You assert something, I'm tall, and you attempt to prove it by saying, I'm tall because I'm I'm taller than most people. It's circular. You're not saying anything new. And a fallacy is something that's just not true. So the great tautological fallacy that everybody in this country learns from school, from the news media, their whole lives, it's bombarded into them, is that America is a force for good in the world. And anything America does is done, it's a good thing, or it's at least done with good intentions. So US is the only country in the world that's dropped nuclear weapons on civilian populations, but it must have been done for good reason. America carried out slavery for hundreds of years, but it's a shining beacon of freedom. America stole half of Mexico in a bloody war of conquest, but America's a force for good in the world and has the right to protect our borders against those same very people. I mean, it's a fallacy, but it's so much what people are bred on that they have a hard time, that their logic is suspended. That America must be good, the flag must be good, the patriotism must be good, but it's not. It's a way of blinding you to the harm that this country has meant throughout history and continues to mean. I mean, this country, I believe it's 104 times the US has invaded, backed military coups, or sent troops to train death squads and work with tyrants in Latin America alone, just in the 20th century. This is not a force for good in the world. It's not a force for good in the world when it trained death squads, when it's not a force for good in the world when it invaded Vietnam and dropped napalm and incinerated the flesh off of children. This is not a force for good in the world, and as long as people keep thinking that, it paralyzes them to the full implications of what they're going along with.
The national anthem. There is a line that says that the US is the land of the brave. If 99% of the population, like the Occupy Wall Street movement, was protesting that only 1% of the population control the 99% of the population and is, quote unquote, unjust.
Yeah.
How brave are Americans that are led than 1% control 99%? They're really brave. Why they do not react to all this?
Well, I think the great tautological fallacy that American chauvinism is a big part of it. For example, and I spent a lot of time down at the Occupy protests, and people did say a lot like you're saying, you know, the 1% versus the 99% in this country. But if you pull back the lens, actually, this country is living off the exploitation of people all over the world. And that we've got to expand our lens on that. I think it's the 43 richest people on the planet control more wealth than half the world's population, 3.5 billion people. So it's not, if you look at the inequality in this country is enormous, but you stretch out the lens and you look at the world, it's the children in Bangladesh who are in sweatshops making our clothing. It's the people who are being driven from their homelands in Mexico. Trump is a liar. NAFTA did not rip off American workers. It destroyed the agricultural economy of Mexico, drove so many people from their homeland. Same with CAFTA in Central America. This is part of why people have come and fled their homelands in desperation, seeking a better life, coming to this border. People don't want to leave their homes except that they're forced to. And then they're criminalized. They're called rapists. They're called animals. They're put in tents. There's all of this demonization. So I think we have to continue to pull back the lens and look at not just the inequality in this country, the injustice in this country, but what this country does to the world. And it is disgusting to me, that American anthem. It is disgusting to me that people put their hands on their heart and they don't think about what they're saluting. The conquest, the invasions, the exploitation. And I have to give tremendous respect to Colin Kaepernick for taking a knee and helping people wake up.
Who is that person for a weird audience?
Yeah, Colin Kaepernick is the sports NFL player who hasn't been hired for several years now, but he came out during the national anthem and he kneeled. And he did it because he said, I cannot stand in full respect for this flag and this anthem as long as this country is killing black youth. The police are killing black youth over and over and over again, and they never go to jail. How can I show my patriotism for a country that does not care about black people? And he was very right to do it. He inspired millions of people. He was attacked by Donald Trump. Donald Trump said people who kneel for the flag should be kicked out of the country. I mean, this guy is a fascist, but it was incredibly courageous and righteous of what Colin Kaepernick did, and a lot of people have been inspired by him.
Noam Chomsky, we're talking about the linguist and famous philosopher, if you want, is saying that in the US there's no two political parties. It's only one party, the business party. And my question is, Is this, if that is true, is this a democracy?
Well, I would say I have Bob Avakian, the revolutionary leader, he has a different, I think, a deeper analysis of what's going on. There are two parties. They're ruling class parties, and there's different factions among the rulers. There's a fascist wing, and there's a more mainstream imperialist wing. And they're having a vicious fight right now over which direction the country should go. Should you rip up the international alliances that were forged after World War II and go it alone and be even more openly gangster the way Trump wants? Or do you want to try to hold together coalitions the way Obama had tried to? But they're all imperialists. And what Bob Avakian says is that the essence of what exists in America is not democracy. It's capitalism, imperialism, and the structures and mechanisms and institutions that serve that. And at times it serves the rulers to pretend to be more democratic and bring people into the process and let them pick, do you want this one to rule over you or that one to rule over you? And at times they decide it's in their interest to be more terroristic and blatant about it. But it's a democracy for the ruling class, but it's a dictatorship over the masses of people.
Precisely. Jill Stein, you know, she was the presidential candidate for the Green Party.
Yeah.
She says that in reality, she doesn't have chances to really compete and break the two-party system.
Yeah.
So in another countries of the world, you have Brazil that with what a labor leader that was Lula da Silva, reached to be a president. Is many, many people in the U.S. say that if you are a common person with no money behind you, you will never, ever be able to make it to the presidency because it's already a very selective club or system or group.
Yeah, that's true. And it is absolutely true that you have these sort of insurgent candidates or Green Party candidates, they don't really have a chance. But I would say because of the way it's set up, but the more fundamental thing, I think much more important is that even if they did, it's not who's in charge of this system, it's the nature of the system. And so you could change who's on top. And a lot of people were played and allowed themselves to be fooled by putting a black president in office. Obama, they thought, oh, he's different. But actually, he carried out more deportations than anybody before him. He carried out drone strikes against the people of the world. He, when people rose up in this country, after the young black man, Freddie Gray, was murdered by police
in
Baltimore. Oh, okay. It was later, but also during Ferguson. But after Baltimore, there were people who protested and rebelled to a degree. And Obama came out and said, they're thugs. The people who rose up are thugs. He didn't say the cop who killed Freddie Gray was a thug. He said the people who rose up against it. So my point is that if you are going to be in the White House, if you are going to be in the Congress, if you're going to be in the courts, you are going to be administering a system. And if you want a different system, you can't just change who's in charge. Even Jill Stein would be beholden to the same system if she made it, which she won't. But you have to change that system. That's a revolution. You're overthrowing that system.
And where's the media on all that?
Well, the media is the ruling class media. I mean, you have the mouthpieces. They report things that are, you know, that promote the great tautological fallacy, that promote America as a force for good in the world. It's part of the problem, yes. I mean, Fox News is straight up fascist propaganda. But even CNN and MSNBC, you watch them and they train people to think just like the elections do. The scope of your choices are, what do the Democrats say and what do the Republicans say? But nowhere in there is, what do the masses of people really need?
Jill Stein is out there.
Well, it's deeper than Jill Stein. I mean, I have to say, Jill Stein, look,
but
she's a more critical voice.
What I'm saying is another voice.
Yeah.
What I'm saying, Jill Stein to a third party, a third voice. On that. We didn't hear Bernie Sanders at the very beginning of the Democratic pre-race.
That's true, but here maybe this will illuminate it more, is that in America, you can't, or under capitalism, you can't have the right to eat. Because the right to eat is in conflict with the fact that food only gets grown and shipped and traded if somebody makes a profit. And if you start to give everybody the ability to go grab the food they need, because what could be more fundamental than the need to eat, it runs into conflict. Even if you had a politician who wanted to do that or pass a law, you need, in a system driven by commodity production and exchange, by profit above all, everything is governed by that. And so that sets the scopes for what the politicians can do. And to change that, you have to overthrow that. You have to overthrow that system through an actual revolution. And this is, look, it's not the same as driving out a fascist regime. driving out a fascist regime, you still have the same system, but you don't have fascism. And that's very important. But fundamentally, I'm fighting for an actual revolution. This is what Bob Avakian has written, a constitution for the new socialist republic in North America. He's developed a strategy. He's developed a new communism, a way that we could, it's insane that we live in a world with 65 million refugees, with 1 in 3 women on this planet will be raped or beaten in her life. This is not human nature. This is not necessary. There's no scarcity on the planet. This is not the problem anymore. For a long time it was scarcity. But with capitalism, you have enormous productive capacity. You have the ability to house and clothe and feed and take care of everybody, not just materially, but a rich intellectual and cultural life. But one thing stands in the way, and that is this mode of production where nothing gets made or exchanged unless somebody makes a profit, and where that's enforced by armies and militaries and border walls and concentration camps and death squads and all of this around the world. And that has to be overthrown for humanity's capacity to care for ourselves, to live a different way, to be unleashed.
We did have the opportunity to interview Luis Barrios, a priest. He was mentioning about poverty. And he, for example, you know some statistics. We know that 1 in every 5 Americans need food assistance, 1 in 7 food stamps, 1 in 3 kids under 10 need food assistance. So there's a problem of poverty at the point that they don't have enough food to eat. And then we were discussing that with the priest Barrios, and he said, when I talk to people about poverty, they said to me, what poverty are you talking about? Where are the poor? So he underlines that there is a lack of awareness or conscience or interest in being informed to admit the reality. And if that is the case, how are you going to do a revolution with the people that are not aware that thing is as grave as the statistics show that it is?
Well, it's a fight. I mean, in this country, it's very atomized and it's very segregated. So it's very possible people can live 2 blocks away from each other in New York in penthouse apartments, multi-million dollar apartments, and people living in homeless shelters or on the street. And they don't know anything about each other's lives. That is a challenge. But part of the point is you have to make a revolution, you need a revolutionary vanguard, you need a party that's out there propagating the need for it, that's uniting with people who are outraged. Millions of people are not satisfied, but most of them do not know a different world is possible. So a big part of making revolution is going out, leading people to stand up against the crimes of the system, against the murder by police, against the sexual assault, against the degradation, against the attacks on women's right to abortion, against the wars, against the concentration camps and detentions of immigrants, to lead people to stand up, but also to lift their sights, to know that there's a way out. And so a big part of what the revolution does is we promote the leadership and the work of Bob Avakian, the website revcom.us, so people can know there's a movement and it's national. It's small, but it can grow. And one thing is, if you know the way out, if you have the scientific understanding, then you can bring forward the people and you can get out of this. If you don't know where you're going, you could have millions of people and you just get played and you end up in the same trap. We need the people. That's part of why I want to talk to everybody about this. The world doesn't have to be this way. There is a new communism. There's a party, the Revolutionary Communist Party, that is fighting for that. And then there's a movement that goes beyond the communists. Because you don't have to be a communist to recognize that we're facing a danger with Trump Pence. You don't have to be convinced the whole system has to go to know that you don't want to go down the road of genocidal ethnic cleansing that we're on now. And that is what refusefascism.org is. It's a movement of people from very different perspectives standing together. And the vision is that we have to take it on ourselves to drive this regime out. Fascism cannot be voted out of power. You cannot sit back and wait for Robert Mueller to do it, the investigations going on around Russia and Trump. You can't sit back and wait for somebody else to handle it. We have to rise up, the people in this street, in nonviolent mass political protest along the lines of what people did about 2 years ago in South Korea. People went in the streets, millions of them, and they went week after week after week after week until they got their president out of office. And everybody said it wasn't possible, and it didn't look possible until people made it possible through struggle. They did it in Armenia two, three months ago. They've done it in different parts of the world. In America, because what happens in America affects the whole planet, people here have to rise up and drive this regime out. And that's We as communists are working on that, but working with others. With Luis Barrios has actually been working with us and others in refusefascism.org from different perspectives to say, this nightmare has to end, the Trump-Pence regime must go, and we're the ones who have to do it.
What about fascism in the rest of the world? What do you hear and see in Latin America and Europe and the other countries and other continents?
Well, it definitely is a huge danger. The white nationalist, Eurocentric populism and fascism is rising all over the world. And you see, actually, with Trump, a real forging, and with Mike Pence, a forging of sort of an international white West alliance against the dark brown countries. I'm not trying to be crude, that's the way they think of them. You know, Muslim countries, the quote-unquote S-hole countries. And you see a lot of this nativism, nationalism, and fascism rising. And so it only adds to the import of people in this country standing up, because what happens here sets terms for the world. If we drove this regime out, it would strengthen the movements of people all over the world against the rising fascism.
Is it an uphill battle?
You know, it is. It's an uphill battle, but I have to say, it's 1,000 times more realistic than voting them out. It's 1,000 times more moral than sitting back and letting fascism be consolidated. And there are people in this country, and I want to say straight up that I know so many people have that inner voice inside their head. I should be doing something. This is bad, but nobody else is doing that much. Maybe I could go along. Maybe it's not so bad. Maybe I just think that. You got to listen to that voice that's sounding the alarm. We saw this in Nazi Germany. The German people sat back and they waited. Most of them did not like the Nazis. Most of them were not Nazis. Most of them didn't support Hitler, but very few of them stood up against him. And it's not enough to dislike Trump.
Do you compare Hitler with Trump?
I think Trump is more dangerous.
Why?
He has nuclear weapons. Hitler did not have the most powerful military in the history of the world. He didn't have nuclear arsenal. He didn't have dragnet spying. He didn't have a system of mass incarceration when he came to power with 2.3 million people already in prison and concentration camps for immigrants who have already been registered and had to give their fingerprints and all of this.
And families separated.
And families separated, exactly.
And what do you think that is going to be, if you have to make a forecast, is he going to be Trump reelected in 2020?
If he's not driven out, I think so. If he's not driven out by the people, I think that that's very likely. I don't have a fortune. The world has been crazy. Anything could happen. A lot of crazy things, unexpected things could happen. But I'll say that if the people don't stop fascism, if the people don't rise up, then maybe there'll be a change of the players. You know, even if Trump got removed somehow, which I don't think is likely, you have Mike Pence, who is also a fascist, a Christian fascist, somebody who wants to torture the gay out of people, who wants to slam women back to the dark ages without birth control or abortion. When he was governor in Indiana, he put a woman in prison. He put a woman in prison for allegedly self-inducing an abortion. Maybe she did, maybe she had a miscarriage. She ended up in prison. A woman who can't access abortion, that's a crime of the state. You better make the abortion more accessible. No woman should be forced to have a child against her will or risk her life to avoid it, and then to throw her in prison. This man, if you don't have Trump, you have Pence, if you don't drive out the whole regime one way or the other, this is going to be a very catastrophic situation for humanity.
So finally, are you optimistic?
Communists are optimists. Communists have to be optimists, but it's not because I'm confident in what people are doing right now. It's because I know what's fundamentally in the interests of people and what they're capable of. And this regime is against the interests of more than 99% of the planet. And the people in this country, if we work at it, if people find their courage, if people connect with refusefascism.org and do the right thing, I think we have incredible power if we go into the streets to stop this regime.
Sansara Taylor, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you.